Right, so I was recently asked by someone, how do I image my artwork for prints? Because I had mentioned that I do it all myself. And so I thought I would basically just throw together a very quick video talking about it. I do it myself. I don't print them myself. I send them off, I send the files to professional printers to have them done. But the actual imaging itself, I do in here. Traditionally speaking, the best way to get your artwork imaged is to actually to have it scanned. Now, to have your artwork professionally scanned, it does involve using a professional company, unless you have heaps of cash and can afford one of these great big bloody machines and all the expense of maintaining one. For me personally, to pay for someone to do that, and on top of either having to travel to them, which is a good couple hundred mile round trip to get to the nearest one, or to send artwork out, you know, with all the cost that's involved in that and the potential risk of it as well, it just isn't feasible. So I image it all myself, and what I use to image it is this here. Now, this is a Nikon D3200 camera, digital SLR camera, with a Tamron f2.8 lens. I've had this camera for a number of years now. The lens was purchased separately. The lens was actually purchased for photographing the Northern Lights, because I do a lot of astrophotography and Northern Light photography. But you know, I'm not a photographer by any means. I don't know any technical stuff about cameras or any of the. I mean, I just use this thing here and kind of hit it on auto and away we go. I do know how to take photographs at night. But other than that, I'm pretty useless with these things. The lens itself was actually more expensive than the bloody camera. You know, go figure, but it is a fantastic lens, a nice wide aperture on it there, you can see, and gets fantastic quality prints off of this. Now, this isn't the most expensive digital SLR camera out there by any means. A lot of purist photographers would consider this to be kind of entry level for a digital SLR, I suppose, but you know, just what's sitting in my hand here is about £600 or £700 worth of equipment, so that's the kind of money you can be talking about. That is what I use, and obviously I have a tripod that I sit this on. When you're taking the image, basically when that shutter goes, your hands don't want to be anywhere near the camera, because any movement from your finger pressing the shutter release button here, or anything else, it will affect the actual image. You will get blurring on it. If you do have something like this to take your images, when you've got it on the tripod, just make sure that if you have this image stabilization motor on your lens, just make sure you turn that off. Because if that's on when it's on your tripod, it will actually move and could potentially blur your image, so just make sure that's off. But yes, when you're taking the actual image, your hands don't want to be on the camera, so either set it on self timer, I would suggest 10 seconds, for no other reason than just to give the camera enough time to stabilise itself and be nice and still for when the shutter actually goes. Or of course you can use a shutter release cable if you have one, or if you're even more posh, you can use a remote such as this here, and basically just point it and that's it, click. Simple as that. The next thing is lighting, and the lighting is probably the most important thing. This here is what you call a soft light box. Now, I actually have two of them. There's one at the other end of my workshop as well, and they're basically both facing in it, so roughly about 45 degrees. It's not exact, but it's roughly about that. And when I'm imaging my artwork, I can actually just set something down on an easel on the work surface along here, smack bang in the middle of where the lights are sitting, because the light, your light source, you want that to be an equal distance from your artwork or whatever you're photographing. You want them to be at equal distance. That's quite important. Now, these weren't expensive. A lot of people assume that they are. They weren't. I got a set. I got the pair with their tripod stands, the light bulbs, actual light boxes themselves, the covers, and also two backdrops as well, plus carry bags that you could fold everything down in the very small bags and carry them with you anywhere you want to go, for just under £40 delivered to my door. And I think that was on Amazon. I'm not 100% sure. It was either Amazon or eBay. I don't really use anything else online. But yeah, £40, and you've got studio quality lighting. Now I generally have them on all the time anyway, just to give a bit of extra light in here. You know, I do have two very large windows here, and during the summer I've got the door open, but it just adds a bit of extra light. And these are sort of, you know, almost as close to daylight as you can get, a very neutral light. So that sort of thing is important. If you don't have light boxes such as this, you can actually take your artwork outside, or even indoors near a window on an overcast day, and use the light from that. I did that when I was first starting out, before I bought these. In fact, even before I had this thing here, before I had the money for this, I actually used a cell phone, believe it or not. But the cell phone does limit the size that you can actually print, because no matter how many pixels the camera has got on your cell phone, it is only going to take in so much information. Now, the phone that I'm filming this with is a Sony Xperia ZX Premium or something like that, and I think the camera on that is 19 megapixels, but it's good enough for taking photographs to upload onto Facebook and Instagram and all that shit. But realistically, the largest print that I could get quality wise before it starts to diminish from the camera that's on this would be about 10 by 8 inches. Any bigger than that and you'll start to lose things in the image, and it'll kind of get fuzzy and a bit grainy. That's in my experience. You may have different experience to me, but that is a camera that I use now. And just to let you see the quality of prints that we can get from this kind of thing here. Now, I can actually print, the largest print that I do at the moment is 4 feet wide, 4 feet by 3 feet. And that's all done with this. And that is every bit as sharp as a print that is 10 by 8, like this one here. Okay. I don't know if I can go any larger than 4 foot by 3 foot. The guy who does all my printing, that's as big as his machine gets. It is. I could probably go, I reckon, up to about 7 feet wide before we start to lose a bit in the image. But, you know, not many. There's not a huge market for 7 foot wide prints, or 8 foot and beyond. So it's really not a concern for me. But the type of quality, I mean, that's the sort of quality that I'm getting from my imaging. This is a female Boba Fett that was commissioned by a customer. So I've done a few prints of it because it was a very popular image. It was a pencil drawing. This was an acrylic painting with spray paint as well on canvas. This is just a normal Boba Fett. And this is quite an old one. Now, this one was actually taken on an iPhone. Now, I think it was an iPhone 4. It was back before I had any sense and decided to ditch an iPhone. This is probably about 6 years old. So that gives you an idea of where camera phone quality was at that point. But this is about as big as I can do this print. It's the pug dog there. As you can see, it's actually retained a lot of the detail in the eye and on the fur. Now, the image, it hasn't blurred it at all. It's actually turned out really well. Even my signature has actually stood out really well on it. And that was just a phone picture. So, you know, you can do it with a phone. Same rules would apply. You know, get it on a stand or a tripod of some description, or leaning against something, and use a self timer. You don't want to be touching it when you take that image. And just a few more that I'll show you, just to give you an idea. And just to kind of show off some of my work as well, because I know a lot of it isn't actually on here. But these are just some smaller prints. This is the kind of thing you could do with a cell phone, no problem. These are sort of smaller 7x5 prints. That's a Terminator T-800 there. Pencil drawn on pastel mat. This is a Harley Quinn's ass. Again, quite a popular image for obvious reasons. That was pencil and watercolour. This one here, which was good fun, if anyone recognises that wee guy, that was pastels. This was an oil painting. Now, one thing with oils is they will give off a lot more glare, so you probably have to play around with your lighting a little bit. This one was again acrylic and spray paint on canvas. It's an Stobart rally car. And another Harley Quinn. And as you can see there, it's a very sharp image. That's a pencil and ink drawing with watercolour in the background. And as you can see, it's very, very sharp, very crisp, very clear. And that's the sort of image that I can do up to sort of 4 feet wide. But that's the sort of thing you can expect. You know, you can do it with no equipment. As I say, if you don't have lighting such as light boxes like this, you can do it outside on an overcast day. If you live in a country where it's sort of perpetually sunny and there's hardly ever a cloud in the sky, I would suggest you kind of do it indoors. If you have a room that has a window at either end, place your artwork on the floor and image it that way. I found that actually works quite well as well. Again, when I was first starting out, that was something I did quite a lot. I actually have, my living room has a window at either end, and usually I would wait until kind of later on in the day, because my house is one end of the house is south facing, and obviously the light was stronger coming in one window than it was the other, so I'd kind of wait until late afternoon when the sun had kind of moved round, so there was a bit more equal lighting between the two windows, and I would actually just place the piece flat on the floor and kind of lean over it and have the camera or my phone, whatever it was I was using at the time, set in such a way on the tripod that it could take the image sort of from an overhead perspective, and that gave a nice evenly lit image. It was quite a useful thing to do. So that's it. That's what I use for imaging my artwork. What I do is I keep these files. I do tweak them a little bit on the computer. I'm not a Photoshop expert. I'm not even a Photoshop beginner. I'm hopeless with it. But I can tweak a few things just to kind of make colours jump out a little bit more and make the artwork stand out a little bit more. And that's really all I do. I will save them as TIFF files so that it maintains all the quality. If you save them as a JPEG, it actually compresses it, so you lose some of the information from it. And I store all these images on I have a couple of external hard drives. I have them all saved on my laptop, and I also have a couple of flash drives as well. And when I want to order them, I just go to the guy who does my printing, I email him the images that I want, he prints them off and sends them to me, and then I just check them and send them straight back out. That's how it's all done. Simple as that, really. If you have any questions at all, just give me a shout and I'll do my very best to answer them for you. Thank you very much for watching. Cheers for now, guys.